So welcome back for our final session of today's event. I'm Joe Aldy. I'm a professor at the Harvard Kennedy School, and I'm a contributor to the project that we've been here today to discuss. Since we yielded a few minutes to the gentleman from California and Indiana, I want to get started quickly with the session. First, I want to introduce my colleagues on the panel. I'm thrilled about the conversation we're about to have. I'll go in alphabetical order, first with John Cannon, who is the Blaine T. Phillips Distinguished Professor of Environmental Law, the Hunting and Williams Professor of Law, the Director of the Environmental and Land Use Law Program, all at the University of Virginia School of Law. John served as General Counsel at EPA and as Assistant Administrator of Administration and Resources Management during the Clinton administration. Megan Ceronsky is the Executive Director of the Center for Applied Environmental Law and Policy. Thrilled to have a fellow Obama alumni on the panel with me. Megan served as Special Assistant to the President and Associate Counsel to the President in the Obama White House, and before that she served as Senior Advisor at the Office of Energy and Climate Change in the White House. Jeff Holmstead is a partner at Bracewell and leads their Environmental Strategies Group. Jeff is the longest serving assistant administrator for the Office of Air and Radiation at EPA during the George W. Bush administration, and had experience working on the 1990 amendments when he was an associate counsel to the president and the George H.W. Bush administration. And then Vickie Patton, who's the general counsel at Environmental Defense Fund and leads EDF's U.S. Clean Air Program. And like everyone else on this panel, had experience working in the government back in the 1990s, working on the Clean Air Act amendments within the office of the general counsel.
Working for John Cannon.
Working for John Cannon. So
no, I work for her.
No.
So before I start asking slash peppering questions of our panelists, I want to share a few insights from the work that I produce as a part of this project, which, as was noted earlier, was focusing on fuels. And there's a lot of different ways in which we use the Clean Air Act to regulate the pollution that comes with the way we burn fuels for transportation. There's some experiences such as with lead, getting lead out of gasoline. We've used boutique fuel policies and reformulated gasoline to address concerns with ozone and carbon monoxide. We've seen more recent efforts to try to promote the use of biofuels through the renewable fuels standard. Let me quickly note sort of one, I think, true success story and one frustrating experience. The success story is without a doubt getting lead out of gasoline. We've reduced ambient lead concentrations in America by more than 99%, primarily because we got lead out of gasoline. It's a wonderful example about how to take new information, new knowledge, adapting policy, where EPA had the discretion under the Clean Air Act to revise the way we implement our policies to reduce the lead in gasoline. It's also a sign of how we work with multiple instruments at the same time, as was already noted. It wasn't just that we needed to get lead out of gasoline for the sake of addressing lead, although we were regulating it as a national ambient air quality standard at the time, but also because it helped enable new technologies in motor vehicles through catalytic converter technology to address some of our concerns about ozone and other pollutants. So the lead example is clearly one in which we see the government being adaptive and using new information. It's one where the approach taken, especially in the 1980s with a phase down of lead, leveraged a market-based approach with the tradable credit program, which is really the first time we see an effective use of market-based instruments in our clean air policy. And it's one that's clearly durable. Now, part of that, I think, is the nature of sort of, in a sense, a technological lock-in. Once we started making motor vehicles with catalytic converters, once the refineries adjusted their specs to make unleaded gasoline, there wasn't anyone in the business community that said, we want to reverse these regulations. That's really ensured long-term benefits, and if anything, we learned out more later how important it was to get lead out of gasoline than even our understanding of the science at the time. So it's clearly been one of the true success stories of the Clean Air Act. In contrast is the renewable fuel standard. There's a number of things one could say about the renewable fuel standard. I would say you could have a number of people talking about it and they would all disagree on which part of it was most frustrating, but none of them would really be championing it. It has not delivered on our objectives of really driving lower carbon biofuels as a substitute for petroleum-based gasoline. It's been implemented through sort of two parts, the original RFS from the 2005 Energy Policy Act, RFS2 from the 2007 Energy Independence and Security Act. It's actually a case where we've seen Congress legislate something would they focus, in the case of the 2007 law, to address climate change. But what we saw is that Congress was quite prescriptive in setting goals, which we learned subsequently were technologically infeasible. where the goals for cellulosic ethanol and advanced biofuels, the really low carbon ways of producing biofuels, have been way out of whack with what the commercial market can deliver, where in good years we're delivering at about 1% of what was the statutory goal for that year. Now, there was a process to try to give EPA some discretion to sort of adapt to this, but it's been a very cumbersome process. It's been one subject to a lot of legal challenges. It's one where it's not uncommon for a regulated entity to know how much biofuels is supposed to be supporting in a given year after that year is up. And that's not exactly creating predictability for those who operate on that. And I think if anything, it's still on the books. We're still operating with it. So in some sense, it endures, but it endures in a frustrating sense in which if we could overcome congressional gridlock, we'd probably find a better way of doing biofuels policy. But it's not surviving because there's been broad support and consensus. Let me make one final comment about the issue of sort of process that's come up some today, and how I've been sort of drawing some of my own lessons from this project and how it's informed some of my subsequent work. Now, as you will soon realize if you haven't already, they've asked an economist to moderate four lawyers. So I have my hands full. But as an economist, I want to do a shout out for a carbon tax, because that's, you know, it's in our DNA to like a carbon tax. But one of the things, John, you'll have your chance. One of the things that I think is really challenging to think about the design of a carbon tax and how to make it really work is recognizing, as we've already talked some today, that there are a lot of uncertainties characterizing climate change as a problem and about how well we think different policy responses will address climate change. And so you want to have a policy instrument that can adapt as we get new information. We figure out what works, we figure out more about the climate damages, we may figure out more about what other countries are doing around the world. And the challenge with the tax is, in the US, Congress doesn't delegate discretion on the tax code. Treasury and IRS have incredibly limited discretion on anything they can do, and it's usually something like inflation adjustments. We don't say, if you learn more information, you should increase the carbon tax. Like, no one is actually writing legislation that says that, because Ways and Means and Senate Finance would never give away that kind of authority. It's very different than how we do regulation, where we recognize there are expert agencies that need to have some discretion, that need to build on their own expertise to adjust and update regulations over time, that we realize they have a lot more information and they're much better at it than we are in the statute writing process. But we don't do that in the tax code. So one way that I've sort of thought about doing this is to say, well, what if we had a regularized process where the executive reports to Congress and says, here's the latest on the science. Say it's EPA building on their experience for the endangerment finding or something like the National Climate Assessment. It's Treasury when they're implementing the carbon tax saying, here are the benefits and the costs and the revenues and the distributional consequences. Not unlike what we might think about sort of an ex-ante regulatory impact analysis that we see with regulations, or what I think many of us would like to see in terms of ex post performance evaluation of policy. You'd have the State Department saying, here's how everything fits with what other countries are doing around the world. And that would then inform the executive to go to Congress and say every 5 years, I want to adjust the carbon tax for these reasons. And Congress would say, we're going to do this in a fast track process. And I say fast track because we used to say that with trade policy. I know we don't talk about that anymore. We use trade promotion authority as a term. But the analog I have here is to say, Congress still retains the authority, but it's going to be informed authority, and it's one where they're going to take a proposal from the executive, and they're going to guarantee an up or down vote, and they're going to guarantee it without an amendment. Now, in some sense, you might say, here's what happens when you give the mic to an economist. They assume away, you know, political science, with apologies to Barry, among others. But the idea here is, this is how we do trade deals. Congress says to the executive, go negotiate a trade deal, and you come back.
Yeah.
You need to do a report on the characteristics of that trade deal, demonstrate it's consistent with the guidance we gave you in our trade promotion authority authorization, and we're going to guarantee an up or down vote on the floor. It won't be subject to filibuster, won't be subject to amendment. You could do something like this where you try to bring in a process for reviewing and updating that can somehow manage some of the institutional barriers that we often see to new legislation. So I'm sure you're looking forward to seeing that bill introduced tomorrow. You might have to hold your breath a couple days, but it's something where trying to think through ways of the future, of some of the insights from how we've done the Clean Air Act in the past, I think can inform the way we might craft our policy response to climate change. And so with that, I would like to hear from people who may have less far-fetched ideas about the future of climate change policy from our panel here today. I'm going to start with a common question for all of our colleagues. And first, I'll turn to Vickie. And that is, Vickie, I'd like you to sort of draw out for us what you consider the most significant take away from the book and how you would use that insight to inform the future of climate policy.
If we were to address the challenge of climate change with the durability and adaptability that is laid out so thoughtfully in this book, we need to really examine and learn from the findings, and I think improve upon the findings, and I'd like to explore both just a little bit. When Congress adopted the health-based air quality standards, the William Boyd chapter is really important in underscoring sort of what where we went from 1967 to 1970 to health-based, nationwide, science-based protections that were designed to benefit all Americans. The goal, the radical goal of Senator Edmund Muskie and Leon Billings was to ensure that every American had clean, healthy air. That gave the modern Clean Air Act, the 1970 Clean Air Act, that modern version of the statute that endures today, so much public legitimacy, right? Because it was about protecting the well-being of all Americans. Likewise, if we are to address the climate change challenge, we need rigorous science-based targets that are legitimate, that say we are going to achieve net zero pollution, and this is a serious-minded effort anchored in science that is really designed to deliver. The book talks about process. The process that the book lays out is really about the rule of law. It's really about participatory democracy. It's about the role of the public in engaging sort of its government. It cannot be overstated. When you look at sort of the step changes that happened under the Modern Clean Air Act, those step changes came from the rule of law. It came when Ellen Silbergeld and Herb Needleman documented the serious lead problems that were afflicting children and took them to the EPA, and citizen lawyers enforced them. It came when David Barron at the Arizona Center for Law and the Public Interest sued on behalf of the American Lung Association to compel EPA to update the health-based PM air quality standards and led to the fine particle NAAQS, because this body of science needed a way to get integrated into the architecture of protecting human health and the environment. And that led to a 1994 court order that led to the 1997 health-based air quality standards. It happened when Jim Mielke at the Commonwealth of Massachusetts said, you must, EPA, carry out your responsibility under the capacious definition of air pollution to address climate pollution. Those are just a few examples of how the accountability mechanisms, what the book calls process, but is really about democracy, was integrated into the Modern Clean Air Act and is so vital. And that means we need to protect forever the citizen supervisions. We need to ensure that EPA is accountable for its actions and inactions in the rule of law, that the decisions that EPA made, that someone had the wisdom to ensure were reformed in the 1977 Clean Air Act with the addition of 307D, are anchored in facts and a contemporaneous docket and transparent and accessible to the public. And we need to do far better, and this is one area of tremendous improvement that's really we've really got to deal with, and that is how do we really, really evaluate where we're at, and in a way that is not based on emissions factors, that is not made up information, but is anchored in the really, truly the best available emissions data, and tell the public every step of the way what are those climate pollution levels like from all of these sources, where we have all of the tools to do that in a way that's far more rigorous. Far more rigorous. The book talks about adaptability. We've got to do far better in incorporating in real time state, local, private sector innovation into national scale policymaking. And right now, one of the single biggest threats to state and local and private innovation is the federal government. And the book sort of describes itself as addressing climate and energy. Right now, the biggest threat to climate progress at the state and local level is energy law. And the Trump administration is using the Energy Policy and Conservation Act to attack California's landmark authority, forged in law in 1967 to protect human health from motor vehicle pollution. All sorts of high polluting industry, they're using the Federal Power Act to attack innovations in climate and clean air and energy at the state level. You know, there are serious threats to climate progress at the state and local level if we don't deal with the intersection of energy law and climate progress and climate law and do a far better job protecting the rights of states and local governments to innovate, ensure that forever the federal actions are just a floor, not a ceiling, and that we're truly integrating that kind of innovation into law. And the last piece is that the great progress that the Clean Air Act has secured, and Anne said this at the outset, you cannot dispute this progress. It is profound. You know, removing the lead from gasoline, desulfurizing the power sector, virtually eliminating mercury from coal plant pollution. Those are landmark achievements that everyone in this room should be incredibly proud of, that, you know, our country is able to translate words on paper into such tangible benefits for the American people. But the real serious additional issue that we haven't grappled with, and that is these broadly shared societal benefits also have uneven costs. And how do we, in thinking about making sort of transformative, bold climate progress, and the way that we have for so long under the Clean Air Act, do a far better job addressing the distribution of costs so that there is no community, no region of the country sort of left behind in the urgent race to address climate change?
Great, thank you, Vickie. Jeff, let me turn to you on your single biggest takeaway and the insights for the future of climate policy.
Well, thank you. And I meant to bring the book with me. Dallas, right there, perfect. So here was my biggest overall reaction, and that is that this book does an excellent job of describing why we have made so much progress under the Clean Air Act. And it identifies a number of specific things. But it's very one-sided because it only looks at it in terms of what has resulted in these enormous emission reduction benefits. There's another perspective that is important as a policy matter and certainly as a political matter, and that is, well, what does it mean in terms of the cost that it has imposed on the regulated sector and on consumers? And Joe, you know, you've heard me say this before, but I can say with great certainty, as someone who spent his career working on the Clean Air Act, that we've spent a lot more than we needed to for the environmental protection that we have. It's for a number of reasons, and we could talk about those, and there's some parts of the Clean Air Act that work much better than others, I think. But as the regulated industry, and as people who tend to represent them in Congress have learned, that there are things about the Clean Air Act that they would be highly reluctant to support again. And I think that's my major point of departure, the idea that somehow it would be politically possible to do what they did in California, which is to say, this is a problem, EPA, you use your best judgment to figure out how far we need to go, how fast we need to get there. I think as a matter of political economy, I don't see how that could ever work. And I also think that there's legal issues with it. You know, we had a glimpse of that in the ATA case when the D.C. Circuit was concerned about the NAAQS program going to beyond the delegation doctrine. I think that if you basically told EPA, it's your job, figure out how far to go, you know, how we need to get there, I think you have a serious constitutional problem, especially with this Supreme Court. So I understand the appeal of legislating a process. I don't think it's realistic. The second point, and this is where I hope it doesn't take me too long. I had this marked in my own copy, but I forgot to bring it up here with me. Number four in the executive summary, and it's very short. Well, I won't read it. it talks about the importance of durability and adaptability. And it talks about the political importance of those two concepts. But then it didn't make the point that I think was important. And if you read that bullet point and that chapter, it essentially what it says is the politics are so difficult that we're not going to be able to do what we need to do. Therefore, we have to do the best we can politically, and then it needs to be adaptable in the future in case technology develops more quickly, in case it's less expensive, in case it turns out there's new pollutants that we need. We need to give EPA the ability to be more aggressive than Congress could ever possibly be. Again, that's very one-sided, because there's no discussion of, well, what if it turns out that technology doesn't develop as quickly as we thought, and it turns out to be much more expensive? What if it turns out to be expensive enough that we have a lot of emissions leakage, that energy costs are significant enough that you see energy-intensive industries that go to the extent that there's flexibility, it needs to go both ways. But the problem with this, with flexibility, with adaptability, and discretion, is that there's a real tension there with durability. And we've seen that already. EPA has significant discretion under the Clean Air Act. You've seen one administration do the Clean Power Plan. You've seen another administration come along, and because they have discretion under the act to completely undo that. And so in terms of the predictability and the long-term certainty, I think there's a real tension there with this idea of adaptability and flexibility. Because I think that just needs to be recognized, that to the extent you give an agency flexibility, even if you only give them flexibility in one direction to be more aggressive, if a new administration can come along and undo that, then you've undermined the predictability and the certainty that you want to have. So I actually think it is important to summon the political will, and I hope we get to talk more about this. I actually think there is a possibility of that happening. I think Congressman Waxman made some very important statements in that regard. And I wanted to just a couple other quick bullet points that I think are important. One of the lessons of the Clean Air Act that I've learned is it is important to have different ways of addressing different pollutants. And the best example to me is the CFC phase out. And here was a class of chemicals that internationally were phased out. And I would say that's the ideal model for the high GWP gases. Now, we've already essentially agreed to that internationally under the Kigali Amendment, and ultimately I think that will be adopted. But the Clean Air Act is incredibly sophisticated, incredibly complicated, and we know some programs work very well for some types of pollutants, and I think that's the model for the high GWP pollutants. The other lesson for me is mobile sources are much easier to deal with than stationary sources. And I actually think that under the current Clean Air Act, that EPA has the regulatory authority that it needs to over time. You know, you have fleet turnover. It's quite different from stationary sources. And for reasons that I'm sure we could all talk about, stationary sources mobile sources are just very, very different. The final point I wanted to make, and I've my good friend Anne, I think, fell into this trap when she described the catalytic converter, that in 1970, Congress just said, you got to get a 90% reduction. Nobody has anybody to do it. But if we just have that goal, then industry will figure out a way to do it. When I was at EPA, I asked about that story, and the people in Ann Arbor said, yeah, that's the story people tell, but we knew about the catalytic converter. We'd done a lot of testing on it. People knew it. It was not just some made-up number. So this idea that technology forcing means that you pick whatever you want, and then you mandate that, and the emission reductions will come, I think is unrealistic. And I think it's good to have aggressive goals, but I think it also undermines the rule of law if you mandate something without having any idea of whether it's actually feasible to achieve. So those are my major takeaways, and I look forward to the rest of the discussion.
Great. Thank you, Jeff. John, your big takeaway and insights for the future.
All right. So my big takeaway was to be refreshed in the history of the Clean Air Act, which I've lived through along with many others in this room, and to see again how remarkable it has been. Although not perfect in every regard. And I was particularly taken in terms of the emphasis on climate and energy, with the success of the NACS program, which took the step of declaring a national goal, uniform across the United States, reflecting the level of adverse environmental effects from air pollutants that people were able to be subjected to. And I think that that was an important step. It turned out to be very successful in organizing efforts and in keeping before the public and all the players affecting the achievement of that goal what the ultimate goal was to be. I think an important complement to that was that there, excuse me, there turned out to be, or there was included, a process for implementing that goal, which was oriented to state decision making with EPA oversight to ensure its effectiveness. The SIP process was essential to giving that goal life, to making it effective, if you will. And that combination, I think, has produced a vast amount of the progress we've seen under the Clean Air Act with less friction than you might imagine or might have imagined between state, local, and federal officials and the various interest groups involved. I think, by contrast, of the Clean Water Act, where total maximum daily loads perform a somewhat similar function for watersheds in terms of defining the total load or the total input of pollutants that's allowable, but has only partial enforcement mechanisms. In particular, it doesn't deal in an enforcement way or a regulatory way with non-point sources, so that engine, although it has it's an analog to the Clean Air Act, has never been effective, and we have serious shortcomings in water quality under the Clean Water Act, in my view, because of the ineffectiveness of that implementing mechanism. So you have a goal, you have an implementing mechanism that's broadly inclusive, that allows variation between and among states, but has this master objective that organizes efforts, I think, in an effective way. So how do you bring that in to the discussion of climate change? Well, the NACS really doesn't fit climate change for reasons that people talk about. If you think of ambient air quality standards as concentrations, you realize pretty quickly that stating a national goal in terms of concentrations of greenhouse gases really doesn't quite work, because concentrations tend to standardize over the globe, so that the United States could do a lot, each individual state could do a lot and still not meet those. But there are other ways of framing a national standard. It could be a national reduction goal that took an end point as the needed reductions in global emissions, and then apportioned that to the United States, and then apportioned that apportionment to the states, and gave people a reasonable target to work toward. And you could have an implementation set of implementation plans with some federal oversight that created flexible implementation through markets and others, as we've already had experience doing under the Clean Air Act with the acid rain trading program and with the NOx SIP calls that have followed. So we have this experience with the right kind of goal established, and that's somebody's, they're talking to me. So the question to me is, how do you establish that goal? If you follow that model, and I think it's a reasonable model, it's not a carbon tax, but it is, or could be, a good cap and trade program, right? If it were set up right. So how do you set that up? And particularly, who sets the goal? And that's really the issue that the book raises and other people have talked about. I don't have an answer to, and it's a hard problem. Because to imagine that Congress would delegate the authority to EPA to decide what the greenhouse gas reduction target would be for the whole country, sort of hard to get your mind around, right? That Congress would delegate so much authority to administer. It's like the delegation of determining what's a level requisite to ensure human health under the NAAQS, but each of those decisions under the NAAQS doesn't have the same level of consequence nationally that a similar determination for climate change. So the idea, just it's a political reality that that might happen. It might be good if it happened because there would be adaptability, there would be some benefits of expert agency determining over time what the level should be. But I don't think that that politically is a workable idea. But then on the other hand, if you have Congress set the level and then leave it, as Congress is wont to do, as Congress did under the acid rain trading positions, then maybe you don't have the level of adaptability that you want. You end up with a standard that's not the right standard, doing work that you don't want it to do. So I think there's a middle ground here that has to occur. And I didn't think about it, but I like when Joe said it, the idea that you would have an administrative agency, an expert agency, coming up with proposals, a proposal that Congress then would vote up or down, yay or nay. So you would have the political legitimacy of a congressional decision, but informed by and disciplined by an expert process. So I'm with Joe right now.
Thank you, John.
Right.
That's fantastic. Yeah. We're done for the day. No, I'm sorry. Megan, your thoughts on sort of the key takeaway from the book and how you think that should inform the future of climate policy.
Thank you, Joe, and thank you for having me here today. I found myself in violent agreement with much of what this book is concluding, in that flexibility and adaptability leads to better quality policy. It makes that policy more durable, that the policy has to be iterative because technology evolves and science evolves, and even our understanding of policy design evolves, and you want that to be reflected in your policies. All that makes a ton of sense to me as a practitioner. And part of the genius of the Clean Air Act is that many components of the Act, although not all, have those different characteristics and have been able to be flexible and adaptable and to be continually improved over time. And there are, of course, parts where Congress got very specific and that kind of backfired, like, for example, a specific number of tons gets you into the Prevention of Significant Deterioration program, which made sense for the number of pollutants, and we got to greenhouse gases. And can everybody hear me? I might not even be.
Can you hear me now?
Yeah.
Everybody can still hear me. Okay. I said nothing revolutionary at the beginning. We see these characteristics in the ambient air quality standards. We see them in section 111, where you have this broad language, the best system of emission reduction that can be adapted to the pollutant and the source sector that is being regulated at the time. You see it in section 202, where there is this broad authority to deal with emissions from mobile sources. There is brilliance in the design of these statutory programs, and they've worked incredibly well as implemented over time. So that, for me, makes a ton of sense as a core takeaway and as an insight for moving forward. However, what if, as a hypothetical matter, you know, we've spent a lot of time today not mentioning the current administration, which has been lovely, but it does exist. So what if you happen to have a set of stakeholders, maybe even some stakeholders who end up in an administration, whose interest is not in making policies more effective and more efficient and more durable, but in fact is the opposite. The interest is in making those policies unworkable so as to frustrate the entire enterprise and to cripple the actual statutory framework. What if, hypothetically, we happen to have some of that happening? So take three examples. The Clean Power Plan, Section 111D, under the Obama administration, you have absolutely everyone in violent agreement that the way that they wanted to actually achieve emission reductions from existing power plants was to use the heavier emitting plants less, use cleaner generating sources more, do it flexibly, make it market-based if you can, like, let us do it that way. We then got into litigation, and you have a whole bunch of voices arguing, yeah, that's what we want to do in terms of actually getting the emission reductions, but no, EPA can't possibly take that into account when actually setting the targets. Now, in the ACE proposal, the administration is taking that extremely broad, flexible language, best system of emission reduction, and contorting themselves into pretzels to argue that they actually don't have any flexibility or, you know, authority to be adaptable at all under the statute. And in fact, not only can they not do something like the Clean Power Plan, but they don't even have the authority to do something as basic as averaging across sources in order to get emission reductions on either the target setting side or on the compliance side. This is objectively terrible policy design. Like, there is no one who thinks that this is a high quality environmental policy design. It is instead a blatant attempt to minimize emission reductions and to take a broad adaptable statutory framework and cripple it, make it into something that is not usable and is not workable, and to try to get a court to say, yep, that's where you have to live going forward. As a second example, take the proposed revised finding that it is not appropriate and necessary to regulate mercury emissions from coal-fired power plants because of a newfound reluctance to consider the harms of mercury that you can't monetize, and a more pretzel twisting to conclude that EPA can't consider the massive co-pollutant benefits that come from reducing emissions from mercury. Now, traditionally, conservatives have argued to great progress that we need to consider the full effects of environmental policies when we are designing them. No one would argue that we improve the quality of environmental policies by putting on blinkers and ignoring some of the effects of those policies. This is literally the opposite of efficiency in terms of policy design. What it is, however, is an attempt to contort the statute to make it harder to address dangerous air pollution effectively. Take as a third example the clean car standards. So this administration has proposed to roll back the clean car standards, and in doing so, they are taking what they describe as a principled stand against flexibility. They are proposing to take away crediting of emission reductions that you can't see when you do the test cycle. So the test cycle is like literally you take a car and you do a test on it and you pretend like you're running it and you see what happens to the emissions. There are things that do not show up when you do that test cycle. Things like, for example, reducing emissions of really potent greenhouse gases from air conditioning. Other components that actually are not even reducing HFCs, but CO2 also do not show up in that test cycle. And the proposal is we're going to yank those things out of the car standards. Again, this is against the regulated industry saying unanimously, like, please give us more flexibility. Please consider this in a comprehensive way because it's much more cost effective for us. This is despite the unequivocal environmental benefits of reducing all of those pollutants and the unequivocal economic benefits of taking a more comprehensive, flexible approach. But the proposal would succeed in making the policy less effective in reducing pollution and less cost effective. So in other words, the question that I am wrestling with in the context of this book, and what I hope this very accomplished group of thought leaders who are working on the book and who are gathered here today will help answer, and it's possible, I haven't read the whole book, so it's possible the answer is in the book, and I haven't gotten to it yet, but what do we do with this insight that we get better environmental policy if there is flexibility and adaptability and then this iterative policymaking design? If we have administrations whose interest is in making those policies ineffective and not durable by putting forward interpretations of those statutes that are inflexible and not adaptable. Is it possible to design a statute that is robust against those kinds of efforts? And an even harder question to take it a step further is, how do you legislate, and Jeff, I think, introduced this question, how do you legislate broad and flexible authority if there is a legal advocacy campaign that has been going on for many, many years in this country to try to get courts to say no? We see that Congress has used broad and flexible language, and we see that there was an intent to provide flexibility to the regulatory agency. But if you really want to do something, agency, particularly in the context of what is the greatest environmental challenge of our or any time, Congress needs to have spoken with extreme specificity to give you that authority. That is the effort that is happening right now in this country, is to try to get that ensconced in the case law. So in the context of that backdrop, how do we then move forward in the context of designing environmental policy and environmental statutes going forward? And what do we do when, like, what actually gets you to really high quality environmental policy design is running up against these interests that are trying to forestall that from being durable and effective?
Thank you, Megan. John, I'd like to turn to you for a moment. If there was one piece of the Clean Air Act that you could bring into future climate change policy, what would that be?
Bring in without revision? Or just, you're just handing that to me.
Yes.
Oh. Well, I talked about the NAAQS. I don't think the NAAQS could be brought into climate change policy as is, or I think there would be significant hurdles to that. I think there's been discussion of another provision of the Clean Air Act, Section 115, which deals with international pollutants. And although that provision has not been well filled out with policymaking or legal precedent, it does have the outlines that would lend themselves to a comprehensive cap and trade system, for example, with the discretion allocated to EPA to set the levels of reduction that would be necessary and to oversee the mechanisms that would be SIP-like mechanisms to implement that goal. There's debate about the viability of that in the existing political and legal climate. I can't argue that that would be a slam dunk, but that's certainly, in my view, of the statute as it currently exists, as a way of comprehensively organizing a response to greenhouse gas emissions, that would be the idea. The alternative is kind of a piecemeal approach. So you take automobiles under one provision, you take, you try to get more mileage out of the stationary source provisions for stationary sources. You look around for other pieces of the Clean Air Act that can be used, and that can be effective, but only to a limited degree, in my view, because I think as a policy matter, and I think as from the point of view of an economists would have to correct me if I'm wrong, it's better to have a comprehensive coverage with a price signal that goes out to the whole economy so that you get the most cost-effective allocation of reductions to achieve the goal that you decided you wanted to achieve. So I think the piecemeal approach is second best, both in terms of efficiency and in terms of coverage. That would be my answer.
Thanks. Vickie, you made a comment earlier about the progress and action that we see at the state and local level and even among private firms. John's made reference to the role of the SIPs. And when we had Congressman Waxman here, it's kind of interesting. If you look back at the 2009 Waxman-Markey bill, it was effectively going to preempt state cap and trade programs for about a half dozen or so years for the national program to get going. But it also had a national renewable portfolio standard that directed, in this case, the Department of Energy, that would be responsible for implementing this, to work as closely as possible with existing states. So when you think about the sort of experience we have, the federal government working with the states under the Clean Air Act, and given where we see so much action occurring at the subnational level now, how do you think about the evolution of federal climate policy that can work with these state and local actors?
We need national climate policy that is really like the analog of the NAAQS, and that is that it really sets out with great clarity the nation's climate pollution reduction targets, our goals. That's what California did do. That's what Colorado just did. That's what Oregon is doing now. That is what is happening sort of across the country in states and cities across the country. And we need to kind of reorient fundamentally from thinking about federalism as either or, right? You know, one jurisdiction or another leads, and really start moving toward a concurrent jurisdiction model where we are within the framework of clear national climate pollution reduction goals that are the analog of the NACs that set our national objectives, mobilizing and enabling bold, transformative state and local action that we can sort of integrate, share horizontally, and also, you know, integrate into national policy design to sort of secure the benefits of all of that innovation, all of those test beds.
Thanks. Okay. Jeff, you noted how you felt like Title VI was effective in dealing with CFCs. It's the right way to go forward with high global warming potential gases like HFCs. You, I think, mentioned that mobile sources, we seem to have a decent way of trying to go after that for tailpipe emissions. Stationary sources, though, it sounded like that's harder to do. So a two-part question.
So I don't think it's harder to do in terms of good policy design. It's just politically it's harder to do.
Okay, so here's the question. So how would you go about crafting, suppose you had the discretion, on crafting what you think would be an effective way at reducing greenhouse gas emissions at stationary sources, and either what do you see as the political pitfalls of that, or alternatively, how would you go about creating the kind of broad enough coalition to have political support for that path?
You won't be surprised to know that I think the only really effective way to do it is through a price signal. And whether that is a carbon tax, including with your idea, although that seems politically maybe problematic, or the other thing that people have talked about that I think would be effective would be a price collar. So that if it turns out that it's more expensive, there's a limit on the allowance price. If it turns out it's less expensive than we thought, you get greater reductions. And so I think from a policy perspective, that's appealing. And one of the things those of us who work in Washington have learned is coming up with good policy ideas is a heck of a lot easier than getting Congress to pass them, even if there's virtual unanimity among sort of policy folks. I'm much more optimistic than I think others are about the likelihood of Congress doing something. And I say that not only because of the attention that this issue has been given, but also because of the desire in industry to have some long-term certainty. It is disruptive. Industry wants certainty. They don't want certainty at any price. They want certainty that they can live with. And one of the things that I truly believe, having lived through the 1990 amendments, is what you need is a White House who takes it on as a priority. And I know people talk about President Obama certainly called for that, but he used his political capital primarily on Obamacare. But more importantly, to my mind, is the White House was not fully involved in the legislative development process. And you contrast with the 1990 amendments, where the Bush administration actually said they wanted something, and they didn't say to Congress, you guys go out and do it. There was a detailed legislative proposal. It went up there. It was, you know, it was debated and discussed, and the compromises were made. And so I think the day is coming in the relatively near future where we would have, and I think, ideally, you have a Republican president, you have at least Democrats in one House of Congress, and that forces the kind of compromises that end up with a system that has long-term legal durability. So I am optimistic that something like that will come. It may not come as soon as a lot of people would like, but I think that's a realistic possibility, not only because of the environmental concerns, but because of the long-term certainty that businesses and industry wants.
I'm going to turn to Megan with a question. Then after that, we're going to open it up for questions from the audience. So I just want to say that to prepare you. Megan, you noted some of the challenges when we give discretion to the agency, that while there's value in adaptability, that sometimes that discretion can be used in ways that aren't really advancing on the environmental goals. If you were advising, say, members of Congress who are trying to think through sort of a climate change policy to go forward, what would be your cautionary tale from the Clean Air Act. Say, here's something you want to avoid doing and what you're going to be crafting in the future of climate change policy.
I wish someone would give me that job. and a Congress that was willing to do something. That'd be amazing. Well, I think to go back to this question of like who sets the number and how do you get there, I do think one of the cautionary tales that Dallas mentioned briefly is the fact that EPA itself is politically constrained. And so EPA did not act on toxics because it couldn't quite face the political implications of what Congress had teed it up to do with all of the characteristics that we think are laudable, right? It was supposed to be science-based. It was, this, you know, they had ample authority to act, all of those things, and they were frozen. And so in some cases, and I think John alluded to this, when you think about the scale of the climate challenge, it is a little challenging to think about EPA on its own coming up with the numbers and then not being so politically constrained that they can actually act to implement this. So I think that one of the lessons from the Clean Air Act might be you actually need a combination of rigidity and flexibility. And especially in describing what EPA is supposed to be getting to and in the context of climate change, the evolution of the science has only been in one direction, that we need to act faster and faster and faster. So if we look at our sort of the risks that face us right now, the odds that Congress would set targets that are too strong seem very low. And so perhaps one of the things you could do is set some targets that are a minimum and that EPA is directed to, at minimum, achieve those targets and to be informed by science if those targets should be strengthened, but have very clear authority from Congress to both get to those targets and to use at least the suite of MET policy design mechanisms that we have now know about in addressing that problem. And this is to some degree the approach that was taken, I think, very successfully in California. This is what has just been replicated in Colorado and elsewhere, where you do say this is where you are supposed to be getting to, so that much is clear and that is no longer a political question. And you do have this suite of tools to go and do it, and your work should be informed by all of the stakeholder interests and all of the science as it continues to evolve.
Thank you. Let's open it up for questions from the audience. You all know the future of climate policy.
No.
One of the things that was talked about this morning, and a lot of you have alluded to, is those successes of the Clean Air Act, the flexibility, the durability, had a lot to do with approaches that were done sector by sector, working with different industries to figure out what could be done and ethically and applying a set of tools. So one thing to consider in terms of what are the lessons from the Act is how do you enable EPA with some congressional direction and opportunities for Congress to step back in if it is appalled at what it's seeing, to work with each sector to apply a set of tools to help them become the best they can be over the next, say, 20 years. And one of the great examples of that, maybe Vickie, you could talk some about the work that's been done with XL Energy out of Colorado. I mean, they're the utility that had always been pretty reluctant to be out there in the forefront of making progress. And not only did they do that on criteria, but now they're looking at a 80% reduction over the next couple of decades. And your reflections on what causes them to do that and what we can learn from it would be pretty valuable.
Thanks so much, Rob. My takeaway from the XL experience is that there's now an economic opportunity in decarbonizing. We have shifted from the paradigm of there's a cost to there is an economic opportunity. That is a game changer. That will enable the kinds of policy action that Jeff is alluding to. XL Energy in December announced that it was going to completely decarbonize its portfolio across 8 mid-continent states.
Wow.
This is in the heartland of the country. They said they would achieve an 80% reduction by 2030. they negotiated, as just an example, with a major steel manufacturing facility in a manufacturing town in Colorado, in Pueblo, Colorado, an arrangement, a long-term contract for utility-scale solar that is replacing the existing coal the steel mill had been relying on, saving the steel mill significant amounts of money. This is the largest energy consumer in all of Colorado, keeping 1,000 manufacturing jobs in Pueblo, Colorado, and then transitioning the two coal units in Pueblo and replacing them with a $2.4 billion investment in renewable utility-scale solar and storage that is saving their customers money. That is the kind of change that is happening, and that is means we're at a pivot point, right? We have shifted, the paradigm has shifted. Do not be timid, right? Do not be timid in taking, because the paradigm has shifted. It is now an economic opportunity to decarbonize the power sector. And all, as we rapidly decarbonize the power sector, we can electrify, right? We can electrify the transportation sector. Right. So we need to think about all of those kind of synergies where we're actually making rapid progress in one sector and actually thinking about how do we harness that to unleash deep reductions, deep decarbonization in other sectors like the transportation sector.
I'd like to emphasize a point there, which I think a challenge going forward when we think about sectoral approaches is that the walls between sectors are falling.
Yeah.
And so, you know, what's going to be really critical to how we're going to decarbonize transportation, to what extent can we electrify transportation, to the extent we can decarbonize homes, can we electrify heating, and get the combustion of fossil fuels out of transportation and buildings. And so it's going to be important how we think about policy design. Like, it's still hard for me to get my head around, like, what does the future of fuel economy standards look like if we specify them in miles per gallon and we're going to have more and more electric vehicles on them? Like, it's just yeah, we had a short-term fix where we say we're just going to give some bonus credits for EVs when they're a small fraction of the market, but that's not sustainable in the long term, right? So, like, we're going to need maybe, emissions per mile and think about how we account for the carbon intensity of the grid somehow, maybe a way you do that with a tailpipe standard that you sort of average over the fleet. But, like, there's ways in which you've done things in the past that I think we're going to need to sort of improve on, given, I think, the way technological innovation is changing the lines or erasing the lines between various sectors. Other questions? Yes, I see that one of our leaders has a question. Anne.
Thanks. So this is a question for all of you, but maybe in particular for Jeff and Joe. Is it obvious that EPA is the agency to delegate to? Joe, particularly for you, in the case of a carbon tax, is that where we center regulatory power?
Let me first yield to Jeff.
I have to say, I am increasingly impressed with just the caliber of the people that EPA attracts, and I don't say that just to flatter people who I work with. It really is true. The time I spent there as a conservative Republican was enormously rewarding, just because of the thoughtfulness of the people there. And I would even say this about the Clean Power Plan: I think it was completely illegal. But I was never someone who...
But having said that...
No, but I was never one that said it was going to be enormously expensive. It was a very cleverly done plan that implemented... So I think EPA is certainly capable of implementing tax policy. For me, all of these questions come down to politics, right? I mean, well, politically, whether the Ways and Means Committee and the House and the Senate Finance Committee would ever... give authority to an agency that they're not familiar to working with. So I think it's much more likely it goes to Treasury. But in terms of the practicalities, I think it probably makes sense to have EPA do it just because of their familiarity with the issues. But, whichever one Congress is willing to do would be fine with me.
Yeah, if we can just get it done, I'm happy. I think there is this challenge about whether or not you could actually have, who really has jurisdiction in Congress. And what does it really look like? It's easy from an administrative standpoint to see it as part of the tax code. That, the way economists sort of think about this is you want to hit sort of the bottlenecks in the energy system.
We're already collecting the information we need for all the crude oil and petroleum products going through the economy and all the coal entering the economy on a per unit basis on which you'd apply a tax. Like literally you'd be adjusting two lines and two different tax forms. And from a tax procedure, you've already covered more than 80% of US CO2. The politics are a lot more complicated than that, obviously. I think you could see something where at the end of the day, it's implemented by IRS and Treasury, but with significant consultation with EPA. And the one analog I can think of for this is, back in the Recovery Act of 2009, we created something called the Section 1603 grant. So you could claim this grant in lieu of a tax credit for building wind farms, solar facilities, et cetera. So it's run by Treasury. But the thing is, they are consulting the whole time with DOE National Labs on qualifying technologies. Now, your run-of-the-mill wind farm, they didn't need much help figuring out, is that a wind turbine or not? But for some of the technologies that were kind of novel, they needed some of the assistance. So you could see where they developed a partnership. And maybe there'd be actually a lot of value with creating sort of this expertise across a number of agencies and getting them to try to work together on this. But if someone were to say, hey, I can get a carbon fee, I can pass it through EPW and Energy and Commerce, Ways and Means and Finance doesn't care that there's another committee in charge of something that generates hundreds of billions of dollars of revenue a year, then that's okay. We could work with that too. We had another question right here. Yes.
It's the season when Democrat candidates are seeking the nomination to be for president. And it's the time when candidates consult the likes of you as to what their policy positions ought to be. I'm wondering whether you can inform us without breaching confidentiality whether anybody is getting beyond the question of whether or not they should be for a Green New Deal.
Yes.
Did you hear the last?
Yes, they're going beyond just, they want a Green New Deal. They're trying to figure out more than that.
Is there hope that we can get into some of the issues that we've been talking
about? Others, I've said all I'm going to say, so.
I'm not consulting with any candidates.
Okay.
I was waiting for the call. But What I do, and I don't follow this in as great detail as others, but what I do see is already among the Democratic candidates a more nuanced discussion of what actual proposals and programs might be. So to the extent that that's getting beyond the Green New Deal, I guess the answer is yes, but I think the Green New Deal is helping propel that discussion and put a marker out there for people to respond to. And I think in that...
Polls show that the American people are more concerned about this than they used to be, with
right.
the exception of some Republicans who are less concerned about it.
Right.
But that would tell you that candidates might see opportunity here
right.
in the right position. So logically, they ought to be doing it. I don't know if they are.
Well, I think your point is reflected in the fact that we have climate plans released
right.
from most of the major
right.
candidates
right.
at this point. I don't want to offend anybody by using the word major. there are obviously many, many candidates. They're all wonderful, I'm sure. but that's new. It is new to have climate be a core issue in the context
yeah,
this early
right.
in the primary and where the Democrats are effectively competing against each other with these visions. Now, in my experience with campaigns are maybe not the best time to come up with super high quality strategic policy ideas. So I'm not going to be mortally offended if they don't get too in the weeds. But the fact that they clearly care and want to be ambitious and are being held to a standard of ambition because of the Green New Deal, I think is really exciting as a sort of a new marker of progress.
Yeah, I to echo something Megan just said, campaigns do not have a shadow office of management and budget that sort of rides herd to make sure that there's rigor on every element of campaign proposals. But I think they are thinking about this seriously, and I think it's going to be part of, I think, hopefully a lively debate about climate policy going forward. Unfortunately, we've now run out of time. So I'd like to wrap up. Before we do that, are there any final gems that our panelists would like to share that they feel like, oh, wait, here is something that's going to change the course of climate policy debate in America, if I just got this out there.
Wow. That's a standard joke.
So my objective here was, of course, so we could wrap up now. I would like you all to join me in thanking the panel for their
participation
today. Thank you, guys.
Thank you, Rick. Thank you.